Welcome to my panelists. Nigel seems to have swooped in the nick of time. We're moving from money to another form of discussing commerce, which is the collector of tomorrow. And I thought it would be good to start with Isabelle de la Bruyère, am I saying it right? She is the head of client services at Christie's. EMEA stands for what?
Europe, Middle East, Russia, and India.
Right. It's EMEA. That is your region. And she had previously worked in Dubai and is now based in London. And you know, one of the things that I wanted each of you to address is this idea of boundaries, which is kind of one of our themes for this conference. It just seems, in my having covered the art world, that increasingly these definitions and categories have been falling away. Collectors are collecting across genres, and also sales. You'll see at auction houses like Christie's and Sotheby's are having these theme sales that have some kind of an overarching idea instead of being sort of period specific or subject specific. So to what extent do you feel as if this is a trend that is here to stay, and how do you explain why we have sort of moved away from kind of more segregated collecting from your perspective?
I mean, I think honestly the globalization of the art market is definitely there. I think collectors have now become truly multi-category collectors. I think we've seen a great rise in collectors from all over the world. Last year in 2016 alone, on Christie's.com, it brought collectors from 184 countries. That really shows you the span of people participating, looking at art, looking at Christie's.com, looking at the online sales. And I think it's really, people are now really looking at, I think they're curious. I think when I was in Dubai and starting the Dubai sales of modern contemporary art, it was really in the beginning collectors really buying art from their own country. From then on, collectors, over 60, 70% of these collectors moved on to buying across category into international sales. And so I think it's definitely a trend that's going to continue. And to adapt to this, Christie's in the last several years has really done theme sales, as you say, but also showcase various sales of different categories all together in one week. So that,
like what, for example?
For example, we have classic art weeks, which includes furniture, which might include old masters, which might include antiquities. So the collectors coming to see an old masters will also possibly look at antiquities, and vice versa. And I think that is definitely a growing trend, because I think collectors are definitely starting to be much more multi-category, and we see it.
Robbie Antonio is a major real estate developer. He has established some of the largest number of fashion-branded real estate developments around the world. And he's also a leading notable collector. He's often included in lists of people under 40 as significant. And Robbie, I think it would be interesting to hear you speak to, since you have focused on contemporary in your collecting, to what extent you are feeling sort of like your interests have broadened, if at all, or you know, to what extent your collecting is informed by other areas, or have you continued to sort of focus on contemporary? Kind of talk about your approach to collecting.
Yeah, so I started about a decade ago. I collect modern, actually, and contemporary.
Okay.
And I've gone to different tranches and different sort of philosophies. Started collecting emerging Western and American, but now that I've moved back to Asia, I'm trying to really learn more about the region. And it is true what Isabelle said. I think to be a real, you know, really knowledgeable collector, I think you need to learn all regions of the world. So I'm going to Art Dubai tonight. Someone from Asia going to Dubai is a pretty novel concept, shall we say, for as a collector, right? But it truly means that you need to be cognizant of what's going on in every region. I'd like to learn about African art and so on and so forth. So it's not just about sort of pigeonholing yourself to wherever you're from. I think those days are kind of passé.
Okay. Nigel Hurst is the gallery director and chief executive of Saatchi in London. And I wonder, just over your years of experience, you know, to what extent you have sort of the focus of the gallery has changed, if at all, in response to globalization, and do you feel as if just the way you define what you do and how you present work has changed?
Well, our role's always been very simply to bring contemporary art to as wide an audience as possible, make it accessible, however or wherever it's being made. But I think putting the conversation in some kind of context, people used to talk about an art world, even probably a little more than a decade ago. And what they actually meant was this century-long conversation between North America and Europe. And it's probably only been through inroads in information technology that as the world has grown smaller through information technology, the art world has grown in inverse proportion. And what that has enabled collectors and institutions like to do is really, you know, different influences, different things that were going on in different parts of the world often used to take 5-10 years to filter through, if at all. Now that's pretty immediate. So you can see work being made in all the world's continents in exactly the same time frame, or pretty much. But I think with that comes a responsibility. I mean, the analogy may be a little bit tenuous, but given that we're surrounded by so much sand, I think if one is not careful, you end up with this kind of cultural pond skating, I call it, whereby a few pioneers that really believe that a particular kind of art that they love deserves a wider audience take to the ice. And seeing they're on the ice, we all follow them. But with little knowledge of really how thick the ice is, whether it will bear the weight of our expectations, how deep the pond is, or actually how the pond even got to be there. An example I'll give is the rise, when the political pop artists first emerged in China in the early noughties, they were really pretty much dismissed by a lot of the Western art critics and curators for being derivative. But actually what they were doing in the context of what was going on in China at the time was highly subversive, not only challenging calligraphy as being, if you like, the primary form of communication, but also taking something which so much belonged to the West and creating these kitsch, tongue-in-cheek, consumerist mouths. And it took a while for people to understand what was going on, I guess.
One of the things that I hear in my art coverage is how the strength of the art market is still there, clearly, but that demand has outstripped supply, and that the real sort of crisis or large question now is just inventory and whether there is enough out there. Can you guys address this from each of your perspectives? I mean, Robbie, is it hard to get your hands on what you want? Isabelle, is it hard to, you know, fill the sales? Robbie, Nigel, what are you finding in this regard? Robbie, go ahead.
There's a lot of art, actually. Let's not kid ourselves.
There's a lot of art out there.
I mean, there's an auction there was auction London last week, but it's very difficult to get great, great art. I think that's what you're really after, right? So truly blue chip art is what everyone gravitate towards. And that's why prices are jack up for that particular category or that artist, really, mm-hmm. right? So it's the blue chip of that particular season. And sometimes it's quite fickle. You see emerging artists that go from 50,000 to 500,000 in the span of a year and come back to 70,000 the year after, right? I'm sure Isabelle can actually talk more about that. But I mean, as a collector, it's you have to also be very prudent about your decision-making process, right? And so unless you have unquantifiable resources, then you just have to basically decide which ones you
be
really
selective.
Go after. Be selective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we had Alan Schwartzman on a panel from Sotheby's the other day, and he was saying how he called a client and said he had maybe the last Rothko that's going to be available for some time.
Yeah, number one Rothko just sold for $14 million, I think, last week, which is surprising because it was below the estimate, right? So, and I think my friend bought it or was trying to go for it, and one would suspect it would have gone within the estimate. So it's hard to tell.
Isabelle, do you want to?
I think you're really talking about the top end of the market here. And I think it's two different things to look at the top end of the market and the market in general terms. In general terms, I think, you know, there's a lot of art, there's a lot of galleries, a lot of art fair. that's part of the globalization of the art market. Top end of the market, 100%. You know, we've seen it even in 2016. It was harder for us to get consignments of very good things. There are more buyers out there when it comes to the top end, 100%. But it's a fact. You know, it's a depreciating, to a certain extent, pool of great art, which is more and more becoming to museums or into collections that are actually thereafter given to museums, or with the rise also of the private museums, to a certain extent, you see less and less.
It's come and gone. They're taking stuff out of circulation. Yeah. But regular museums can't afford this stuff at the highest end.
That's not true.
No?
That's not true. There's still, I mean, museums sometimes collaborate. Mm-hmm. You know, we did in 2016 a sale of a Rembrandt in collaboration to the Louvre, and who bought it with a Rijksmuseum. So, no, I mean, it still
it's
happens.
It's possible.
It is.
Nigel, how has this affected you, if at all?
It doesn't really, because we've always focused very much on
new
emerging
work.
Artists, exactly. Mm-hmm. And but I think as well, there's always been different ways of collecting art, and therefore the same problems don't necessarily apply to everybody. And I think also that most collectors start off in quite an eclectic way. They're usually individuals that are wealthy, that find that they've got the cash to do that. You've got to do that to buy something that you can't either eat or sleep in or drive or whatever. And then become more focused over the years when they start engaging with elements of their collection that engage them the most. So it becomes less about the market. So in terms of the future, I think in terms of those exciting times and being able to look at art from all over the globe, hopefully that will free people up to, first and foremost, support artists in the region that they come from, and then maybe supplement that with other art. But it's really, you know, I've got no problem with, you know, the names that we're all talking about or their estates getting that wee bit richer. But I think it would be great as well if the collectors were doing more to support the artists that really need support when they need it.
And also just unexposed areas. There's a lot that you can mine that is kind of less, kind of already over collected.
Very much so.
What about though when you have, it's always fascinating to me that when you're presenting artists who have made work in the last 5 years, that they really have been untested in terms of whether or not they're going to endure. I mean, to what extent is that a risk for a collector, and do you have to convince them? You have to make a different argument for that sale because you're not sure whether or not this artist is going to stand the test of time.
I think different collectors work in different ways. It depends on your reasons for collecting. I mean, maybe I'm being a little bit idealistic, but maybe collect based on what's in front of your eyes, whether you like it or not, rather than always having one eye on the market. Obviously, speculatively, if you're looking to invest in art, that's very important. And I'm not coming from this kind of a judgmental point of view, because artists need people to buy their work, and the reasons are immaterial. You know, if people are buying art, that's got to be good. However, I think sometimes people are losing part of the joy of collecting art, not backing their own hunches more. And yes, there is a risk in doing that, but there's a lot of fun as well.
Robbie, talk a little bit about what you're doing in the Philippines in an effort to kind of expand just the audience.
Sure. So I'm building two major museums by two major Pritzker Prize architects. I started a company about a year. I can't name yet. I will mention one soon. So I've realized to truly transform and create a legacy and impact a population of 100 million people, to do something culturally significant is something that's really fulfilling. So I created a company doing designer prefab homes with the world's best architects, from the late Zaha Hadid to Jean Nouvel and so on and so forth. So I'm doing an art park similar to like an Inno team, which Alan Schwartz I'm sure spoke about, or Naoshima, and really creating a hub for great art to really educate Southeast Asian population of 600 million people about Western art, which is where really I collect, but really trying to help emerging artists from the region as well. And doing so and going to all these fairs obviously will help, because I'd like to bring as well Middle Eastern art.
And what would you say is the goal of those institutions? I mean, are you, is it for the audience?
It's truly not, that would be a nonprofit.
Okay.
So that would be for the public.
And you want the public to be just more exposed to
the art of the region? Because most of the collectors there, and there are quite a bit, I know a lot, are really collecting people from there, from the country or from the region. So it's because I think of lack of exposure, and if I could do something to effect change in that department, I think that's going beyond being a collector. Mm-hmm. It's really being a patron, which is much more exciting.
Isabelle, having worked in Dubai and also in the West, how would you describe sort of the differences in terms of how people collect, how people approach the market? Is it possible to kind of articulate how things are done differently?
I think I've seen a great change in the last 15 years in the region. I mean, I think the cultural landscape in the region has changed dramatically in the last 15 years. I think, you know, having brought before to a certain extent, you had a few galleries. I remember coming to Dubai in 2000, and in 2000 there were probably five galleries in Dubai. Today you have over 80 galleries in Dubai. The bringing Christie's to Dubai in 2006 with them holding, with us basically holding the sales, Art Dubai, even what's happening here in Doha with the museums in the UAE, I think it's really about bringing art to a more general public, and I've seen, what I've seen is much more curiosity, much more something that was not part of their daily life or their everyday life is slowly becoming part of their everyday life, whether it be the art fairs, the galleries, or even the notion of knowing that the museums are coming. But I think we're really going to see it for the next generation, and I think that's really about the next generation more than anything.
Creating new habits of new kinds of collectors. What I frequently hear is that the most promising new sort of constituency of collectors is in Asia. Do you see that, Nigel, in your experience? I mean, in terms of
certainly
what's happening
in terms
with your gallery?
And the number of private museums that are being built. And that touches on another thing, I guess, because when people start collecting art, usually it's for themselves. But then as soon as you open your door to the public, it actually becomes about collecting for the visitor. So that's a different way of collecting art, again, from a private perspective, and actually working out which works will work together in terms of an exhibition program, and which the works that you would like to bring to a wider audience. So two things, very, very different things in many respects.
Okay. Do we have questions from the audience? If you do, please raise your hand. Roger? No. Were you going to add something, Robbie?
No, I'm just speaking out about the private museums. I think there's like this massive number, about 1,000 private museums being erected in China right now. Never heard of that before, right? So obviously the art world has changed.
Right, and you also see like Phillips opened in Hong Kong, that there's a real recognition on the part of the auction houses that that's where the action is.
And you'll see, I mean, Hong Kong Art Basel's next week, right? So it's been, going on for 4 or 5 years right now, but I've been going to all the Basels. It's just as exciting. I mean, it's truly international, it's truly global. All the major galleries are there. So if you feel like you have to go to Basel, I think, you know, it's just become a larger market altogether.
And I know it's hard to generalize about Asian collectors, but are they buying their own culture's work, or are they
both.
Sort of, do they want the Western?
If I can answer that,
yeah.
In 2016 we had over 35% of our sales actually went to Asian buyers. In our last sales last week, we had over 40% of our buyers pool was from Asia, which is a huge number. So it is without a doubt one of the fastest growing markets today. And they buy everything. The reality is that they buy everything. And talking back about theme sales in Shanghai, for example, when Christie's opened in Shanghai, we didn't do necessarily Asian art. We brought theme sales that incorporate everything from Picasso to furniture to jewelry, and it was really about bringing the best of the best to them, which is what they were looking for.
And that was successful.
Very.
Any questions? Yes.
Hi, I'm Susie Sikorsky. I'm a Fulbright scholar in Dubai. I guess first towards Isabelle, your perspective on young collectors, I mean, everyone, I mean, on the panel, maybe what you feel if they have a new taste, I mean, more globalized taste now with social media, what would you say as for young collectors, what you envision them to be collecting, so forth?
I think collectors today, you know, I think the internet's changed everything. I think we were talking yesterday about the easy jet generation to a certain extent, us traveling everywhere. Instagram, you know, for the first time you are brought artists, fairs, things that you like, you take a snapshot of it and suddenly it goes viral to a certain extent. I think the press has been really focusing on the top end of the market, the headlines, the multi-million, but the reality is that's not the market. The young collectors today look a lot at online sales, look a lot at art fairs. You don't necessarily have to be a billionaire to buy art. It starts at, you know, we sell things from £1,000 to £100 million or $180 million. But I think young collectors today look at everything, whether it be photography, but also at different mediums. And I think that's what's interesting today, is the new mediums that are out there to a certain extent, whether it be through, you know, what we saw yesterday with Chow Fei or others, mm-hmm. And the all the different art that's out there and all the different artists that's out there.
It's made it a much more accessible field, and it used to be sort of feel like somewhat elite. Any other questions? One thing I wondered was, there was a real period of uncertainty over the last year that we all talked about a lot, and it was partly attributable to our election being, you know, in the balance, and now we know who our president is. We still don't know the tax implications of his policies, which I think a lot of people are waiting for. And then Brexit was another factor. To what extent has this influenced the work that each of you do, and are you feeling like things are settling down now? We know what the landscape is, or is there, are there still questions that are outstanding? Does it influence you?
I'll answer that. It definitely did influence us. Last week we had, in the last 2 weeks, we had the Impressionist and the contemporary art sales. As I said, you know, so much buying activity from Asia, but also America because of the low pound value. I think Brexit, I think that's one to be seen. You know, it depends upon the how the UK is going to deal with it in terms of tax, import tax, where the market's going to go. I think at the end of it, London will still retain its strong presence within the art market, the European, but everything depends.
I mean, there are a lot of people who question whether it will and whether galleries will close and auction houses will. Already we had, you had some paring down at Christie's, right? You're closing one
yes.
of your offices. What about in terms of sort of controversial art? I mean, Nigel, you've had, I mean, I don't know, were you there when Sensation was done?
Yes.
And that was a very big deal in New York. I don't know if you guys remember. Chris O'Feely's work, and the mayor wanted to pull it from the Brooklyn Museum because it involved religious subjects. To what extent has that defined the gallery, and have you encountered other situations that have felt uncomfortable, things you've had to kind of deal with that have felt like risk-taking?
I think it's all been part of the process. I mean, I think it'd be impossible to recreate that scenario now, or certainly within the UK it would be. But even that was interesting when you mentioned Sensation, because it shows the dangers of censorship, really. Because what exercised an audience in the UK and offended them was completely different from New York, was completely different from Germany.
For the same piece of art?
For the same exhibition. So it was different artists, different works. It's just that it was Chris O'Feely that got, I guess, the major press in New York. I think people's minds have changed. Probably to put it in perspective, in those days, the gallery's annual audience was about 90,000 visitors a year. I mean, now it's 1.5 million. So contemporary art has a completely different audience profile. People tend to be a lot more open-minded. So I think it's far we didn't ever go out of our way to create that controversy. The controversy just created itself because people weren't used to what they were seeing and therefore didn't necessarily want to treat us out. You know, we would get letters during sensations saying, you know, I felt so sullied, I had to retire to my bath at the Connaught. You know, and so it's just, you wouldn't get that now, or I hope you wouldn't get it now.
What about Saatchi as a presence? Is he still sort of very involved? Does it feel like...
Very, very much so.
Yeah.
Yeah, his passion for contemporary art remains. It's an incredible driving force behind the gallery.
What about Damien Hurst? Is he, do you think, going to have a comeback? And there has been some question of, you don't?
Ask Damien.
He has a new body of work coming to Venice, and I think a lot of people are, you know, interested to see if he's kind of his prices come back. And
yeah, you know, but he never went away. You know, he may have gone away as far as the market's concerned, and I don't know. I don't have a view on that. But I think, you know, artists just, you know, they carry on doing what they do, and sometimes they're ignored. Sometimes they have an audience. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes that happens within their lifetimes. It really probably noticed I'm not hugely market focused. You know, the market will take care of itself.
Mm-hmm. Isabelle, what do you think?
Talking about Damien Hurst, I look forward to seeing it. Actually, it is opening next month. I think you're talking about an artist that's probably the most prolific artist in the history, you know, more than Warhol even. So I think it's a question of supply and demand. The reality is, I agree with Nigel. I don't think he ever went away. I think it was just a question of supply and demand.
Maybe he made too much. Mm-hmm. Robbie, is he someone you're into?
I've collected Damien ever since before. I'm long Damien. I'm actually going to buy more of this. I'm going to collect him vertically right now. Much more. Even before you guys, before the Venice thing was announced, I sort of just thought the pricing is correct right now because the dip was massive, right? So I sort of felt that there was an inflection point that I could come back and. Really
so you're
come.
A believer in that he's.
Yeah.
He's worth it.
Maybe more than anything, also, it shows the role of the gallery and the role that the gallery plays with the artist.
In terms of modulating?
In terms of supporting, in terms of promoting.
Yeah, how much you produce. Mm-hmm.
But there's a lot.
There's a lot.
I just did a quick check last week with all my dealer friends, and I'm like bombarded with a lot of
How much work is out there, you mean?
Quite a lot.
Yeah. Any other questions? Yes. Okay, here comes a microphone.
Thank you. It's just a question for you, really, about the choice of architects for museums, again, elsewhere in the world, by the same names. And, you know, I have a lot of respect for these architects and the museums that they're building all over the world, but new opportunities to do new things in new territories that haven't received such institution and such investment. It just pains me sometimes to see the same names again, their landscape expanding to new territories, you know, and having such an impact on how art is presented and the public's experiencing art throughout the world. It just frustrates me. And I hope, well, I don't know, what do you feel about that?
Well, it's a different sort of concept. So I'm doing all these modular homes with them. So I'm taking the technology of prefab or modularity to a different degree. So I wanted to challenge myself and build a museum in about 4 months, not 2 or 3 years. So it's actually a challenge I put to myself, and I challenged them, and I created a design that I will try to prove to myself and to others that I can do that, so the company can do that. So it's basically a modular, movable museum. So, sorry, the question
what
is
about,
why am I using
about,
the architects?
What about using new names, she's saying, outside the usual suspects?
Can I just clarify? So the involvement of those architects is for your modular project,
yes.
Not for the museums?
No, but so the next concept was to create a transportable mobile museum that I will just erect, happens to be first in there. So to answer your question, why the usual names? Because they are great to begin with. Right, so number one, fact number one. But we are using other architects that are, who I think will be future Pritzkers. There's also a lot of architects right there, so just like artists. So you have to be sort of wise who you work with, who you get, and who, right? So it's just a question of who we really believe in as well, who will really create a lasting impact in design architecture.
If I may add, though, to that also museums, and I agree with you, but it's also about creating a buzz and bringing in people to a certain extent, and that's why museums always seem to also use a great big names why is that? It's to attract people. It's the curiosity to talk about it.
That's really it. Think about it. Why are we in Qatar right now, right? Someone like me. I mean, look at this amazing art and architecture that the city has provided. I mean, I come in, go to the airport, I see a big Urs Fischer piece, and I'm like, I feel like I'm really surrounded by art immediately, right? So it is to attract. I mean, a great architect usually will hold a greater audience and great artists. So it's parallel.
Brave, I think, into what we invest in. I understand the power of that in a placemaking, but it's good to just take a bit of risk every once in a while to just expand it for everyone, really.
I do agree with that.
I agree with both of you.
Okay, we're out of time. Thanks to the panel.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And next we have Roger.